One of the skills we need to cultivate as critical thinkers and rational persuaders is awareness. Awareness of our own minds, our own psychology, awareness of factors that can influence the quality of our thinking, awareness of how those same factors can influence other people's perceptions and beliefs, and how others might respond to our efforts to challenge those perceptions and beliefs. In this video, we're going to take a small first step in this direction by paying attention to the different ways that we care about beliefs, different ways that beliefs matter to us. We start with two observations. The first is that some beliefs matter more to us than others. And the second is that the more a belief matters to us, the more resistant it is to change. From these two observations, we can construct a simple model, a mental model of the psychology of belief. For the sake of a name, we'll call it the core belief model. It's a very useful model to have in our heads when thinking about argumentation and persuasion. Here's a simple example. I happen to hold the following beliefs. 1. I believe that the actress Anna Paquin was born in Canada. She's the actress from the X-Men movies who played Rogue. She also starred in the TV series True Blood. When she was 11, she won a Best Supporting Actress Oscar for her role in The Piano. And back then, she had a strong New Zealand accent, which made it easy to think that she's originally a New Zealander. But I've come to believe, I forget where I read this, that she was originally born in Canada. 2. I also believe that climate change is a serious problem. I believe the evidence in favor of a warming trend is strong, and the general predictions of the consequences of that trend for sea levels, shifting climate patterns, and so on, seem quite serious, especially when we look 50 to 100 years down the line. And 3, I believe that, while I'm certainly not perfect, I at least try to be a good person. I suspect most of us think this about ourselves. Now, here's our first point. Some of these beliefs matter more to me than others. I don't care about each of these equally. Now, when I say that some beliefs matter more to me than others, I'm talking about how much I care about whether the belief is true or false. Or to put it another way, how upset or disturbed I would be if it turned out I was wrong about this belief. Now, please don't confuse this with how confident I am that a belief is true. That's a different thing. I can be very confident about the truth of a claim and not care at all about whether it's true or false. I'm very confident that I have a quarter in my pocket right now, but I could care less whether that was in fact true or false. Similarly, I'm fairly confident that this first belief about Anna Paquin is true, but whether this is true or not matters very little to me. If it turned out I was wrong, it wouldn't bother me much at all. On the other hand, my belief about climate change does matter to me, certainly more than my belief about a celebrity's birthplace. Why? Because there's a lot more at stake, one way or the other. If it's true, then it will have significant economic and political and human consequences for many people. And if it's false, if climate change is not, in fact, a serious problem, or not as serious as the scientific community warns it to be, that too has consequences that matter to me. So on this measure, belief 2 beats out belief 1. But belief 3 beats out belief 2. Whether this is true matters a great deal to me, because this is a belief about who I am as a person, about my moral character. If I'm wrong about this, if it turns out I'm not a good person, that I don't even try to be a good person, that would be very disruptive to my identity as a human being. And I want to draw special attention to this fact. This belief stands out from the others precisely because it's a belief about my identity. I'm concerned about climate change, but I'm not invested in this issue in the way I'm invested in who I think I am as a person, what my fundamental values are. In general, when we survey our beliefs and ask ourselves how much a given belief matters to us, how much we care about being true or false, we'll find that beliefs about our core identity rank highest. These are beliefs about what our ultimate goals are, what our place is in the grand scheme of things, what grounds our self-worth, what kind of a person we think we are, and so on. We're often quite confident about such beliefs, but remember, we're not focusing on how confident you are that it's true. We're focusing on how much the belief or the claim matters to you one way or the other. And here's the key fact that we can all recognize, but it's important to be explicit about it. Beliefs about our core identity play a foundational role in our psychology. If these beliefs are disturbed, they threaten the integrity and stability of our psychology. And hence, our natural instinct, our natural automatic response, is to treat challenges to our core beliefs as a threat and to react defensively to protect and preserve these core beliefs. So just to back up a bit, here's the general point. The more a belief matters to us, the more resistant it is to change. If I go down my list, that first belief doesn't matter much to me. I don't have much invested in being right about it. So it wouldn't take much to convince me that I was wrong. If I turned to Wikipedia and it said Anna Paquin was born in New Zealand, I might be surprised, but I'd happily accept that I was wrong about that. Now, for number two, I care more about this issue. I have more invested in the issue, and that means I'm going to be more cautious about changing it. I'm happy to look at arguments against my belief. I welcome them. I don't want to believe something if it's not true, but I'm going to hold those arguments to a pretty high standard. I'm not going to change my mind just because one source says something contrary to my beliefs. The opposing case needs to be stronger than that. But when we move down to number three, the resistance is stronger still. And here, the resistance is different in kind. It's not just a matter of the case against it needing to be stronger. When an issue is connected to one's identity, challenges can be interpreted as an existential threat, a threat to one's very existence, as the person you identify with. So the defensive reaction can often be quite different, more emotional, more visceral. In other contexts, it can be a cooler reaction, but what's anchoring it is still the need to protect the core. Elaborate rationalizations can have this character. Now, when I think about these questions about the structure of our beliefs, I often have a visual model in my head, which I think is helpful. So here it is. I call it the core belief model, and it's designed to represent just the features that we've been talking about. We imagine a network of beliefs that is organized hierarchically so that beliefs that matter more to us and are more resistant to change are closer to the center of the network. And beliefs that matter less to us and are more easily changed are farther from the center. Beliefs that are at the periphery of the network matter least to us and are easiest to change. Beliefs that matter most are tied up with our identity, and these are inside the core. They're core in the sense of foundational to our psychology, and they're core in a spatial sense in this bottle because they're literally at the center of the diagram. And that black ring around the core, that represents the psychological defense mechanisms that we have that are designed to protect the core. In our examples, my belief about Anna Paquin's birthplace is peripheral. My belief about climate change is somewhere between the core and the periphery, and my belief about my own moral character is inside the core. Now, let's do a quick summary of what we said so far. 1. Beliefs vary in the degree to which their truth matters to us. 2. In many cases, we can rank order a given set of beliefs by how much their truth or falsity matters to us. 3. Where a belief ranks in this ordering depends on the relationship that the belief has to the broader set of values and principles that we care about. Now, we could elaborate a lot on this, but for now, I just want to make the point that this will vary from individual to individual. What matters to you may not matter to me, and vice versa. 4. Beliefs that reflect our core identity matter most to us. 5. In general, the more a belief matters to us, the more resistant it is to change. And 6. Beliefs that are close to the core of our identity are most resistant to change and most likely to trigger defensive reactions when challenged. All of this is important for self-awareness about our own belief psychology and for thinking strategically about persuasion and argumentation. Now, on this latter point, we can elaborate a bit further. If we want to change someone's belief about a particular issue, we need to ask ourselves two questions. The first question is, where is the belief located in this person's belief network? This is important because if we're targeting a belief that is closer to the core, closer to a person's core identity, that's going to require a different strategy than if we're targeting beliefs farther from the core. You're going to need to find ways to avoid triggering those defense mechanisms. And second, we need to ask, how do we know where a belief is located in the network? We may think it's obvious, and in some cases it might be, but it's also easy to misjudge these things. I'll give you a real-life example. I know an older gentleman who I'll call Mike. Mike is a lifelong Catholic. He's attended church his whole life. He identifies strongly with being Catholic. Now, knowing just this, if you were to guess what sorts of beliefs lie close to the core of Mike's belief network, close to his identity, beliefs that would be particularly hard to change, what do you think they would be? Well, it would be natural to think that beliefs about church doctrine are important to Mike. Beliefs about the divinity of Jesus and God and salvation and the authority of the church and so on. But in the case of Mike, you'd be wrong about that. Mike, it turns out, is genuinely agnostic about most Catholic doctrines, including doctrines as basic to Christianity as the divinity of Jesus and even the existence of an afterlife. Being Catholic is important to him. But he's willing to admit that the church could be wrong about even the most basic theological doctrines. So, with respect to his identity as a Catholic, what does matter to Mike? Well, what matters to Mike is his identification with the cultural tradition, the rituals of the church service, and the mere fact of being a member of a religious tribe that has a long history. The thought of belonging to no religious tribe is much more disturbing to him than the thought that his tribe may not have all the right answers to deep theological questions. Mike actually cares very little about theological questions. He spends almost no time thinking about them. There's a general lesson here. When thinking about persuasion strategy, we inevitably make assumptions about what beliefs are more central than others for the audience that we're talking to. But it's easy for these assumptions to be wrong. This is why it's always a good idea to treat these assumptions as hypotheses that are open to testing and revision. Now, how exactly can we test our assumptions about where a person's beliefs lie in their belief network? Well, one way, and probably the best way, is through the skillful use of questions and dialogue with your audience. You can use conversation as a tool for exploring and mapping a person's belief network. This is an important argument ninja skill, and it's a topic that we'll come back to and explore in greater depth in a future lesson.